Quick disclaimer, everything in this video and all of my videos are my opinion based on detailed research that I perform. That said, I would recommend doing your own research before you make up your mind. Thank you. So, the verdict is in. As of June 1st, 2022, the jury and the public have decided to no longer buy into Amber Heard's lies. Over the course of 6 years, Amber has had one of the greatest public falls, with her name now literally synonymous with excrement, and her emotional testimony turned into a meme.
My dog stepped on a bee. We went to the vet. My dog stepped on a bee.
My dad has to pee.
My mom's stuck in a tree.
My squirrel got bit by a flea.
So how did it come to this? Let's rewind for a second and look at the standing that Amber Heard had back in 2018, because that was a great year for her. She had already secured a $7 million settlement from her ex-husband the previous year. Her first major role in a blockbuster, Aquaman, was set to release. There was much publicity about her sizable donation to the ACLU and the Los Angeles Children's Hospital, and she was announced as an ACLU ambassador for gender justice. And not to mention, she published an op-ed detailing her struggles in the industry after standing up to and speaking out against violence. It was a good time to be Amber Heard. The public believed her story so much that without an ounce of truth aside from a bruised right cheek, Johnny Depp was getting effectively cancelled. He was dropped from 2 major franchises and was effectively stranded on Me Too Island along with the likes of Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby, and Kevin Spacey. And the reason we all believed her so easily was simple. Her story made sense. In 2016, Amber was an unknown quantity, but strangely, so was Johnny Depp. Amber, because of her general obscurity, and Johnny, because of how privately he had lived his life until then, with only stories coming out about his drinking and drug habits, as well as his diva antics on set, the picture made sense. Older male megastar is abusing and controlling his younger starlet wife, to the point that she needs to secure a restraining order against him. It all added up, but then something changed. Moments from Amber's deposition during a UK defamation trial against The Sun went viral. And this right here changed everything. If Amber was truly the victim, why was it that while recalling and recounting horrific moments of her relationship with her supposed abuser, she was smirking, rolling her eyes, and weirder yet, eating cookies? Like a lot of cookies. Girl, stop. This didn't add up. This was also the time that recordings from the relationship became public, and people started to pick over the details, and they no longer lined up with her story. In fact, people started to wonder if the opposite was true. Maybe Johnny Depp was the one being abused. So, fast forward to May of 2022, with her entire public image in tatters, facing a $50 million defamation lawsuit filed by Johnny Depp, Amber embarked on the task of selling to the jury and the public 5 crucial lies. Number 1, Amber Heard is a timid, fragile woman suffering from PTSD.
And why did you file for divorce? Because I knew if I didn't, I'd likely not literally survive.
Number 2, Amber Heard was being abused and struggled to leave the relationship.
I'm so scared that it was going to end really badly for me. And I really didn't want to leave him. I loved him.
Number 3, Amber hid the signs of abuse expertly from friends, family, and the public.
And then if you want to cover up a bruise, you obviously put foundation first, concealer, and then on top of that, I used a bruise kit. Not a bruise kit, it's a theater makeup kit, a color correction kit, but I called it my bruise kit.
Number 4, Amber cared for Johnny and wanted to protect his reputation. Number 5, for Amber, this was never about money or fame. This was about justice.
I wanted nothing.
Let's start with lie number 1, because the curtain has risen and it's time for Amber to take the stand. This is her time to shine and sell us her version of the tale. And boy, does she go all out.
Why are you here? I am here because my ex-husband is suing me for an op-ed I wrote.
And how do you feel about that?
I struggle to have the words. I struggle to find the words to describe how painful this is.
In her version, she is a timid young woman, committed to her marriage, but taken in by Johnny Depp's charms that were both aggressive and manipulative.
Lifted the back of my bathrobe up and...
Can I just stop you there? Why were you wearing a bathrobe?
Because I was doing a scene. It was a period film, so it took place in the 50s. And so I had all of this old undergarments that are for that time era. And he kind of picked up the back of my robe with his boot. And I kind of turned around and giggled, you know. I didn't know what to make of it at the time. And I just kind of giggled and batted it away playfully. And he kind of playfully kind of pushed me down on this bed sofa that was in his trailer, just playful and flirtatious. And he said, yum. And he kind of lifted up his eyebrows like that.
As Amber recounts the entirety of their relationship, she talks about how Johnny wanted to control her career and her entire existence.
It was dirty that I wanted to do this job that I wanted to do, and I was doing the job of an actress. It was every time I was walking out of the house, he would ask me, "That's really what you're wearing, kid? Oh, I see." You know, I wore a dress to an event once, and I felt beautiful in it. Stupid as that sounds, I felt pretty in this dress I picked out. And I showed it him because, it's a carpet. It's red carpet, so it's, publicized. And I kind of thought it was weird he wasn't saying anything about it. You know, I left him to go do this red carpet. And I was like, "Did you see the event I went to?" You know, basically I felt pretty, and I thought, did you see that? You know, I wanted him to say something about that, I guess. And he said, well, this is after he stopped talking to me for some time, didn't tell me why. When he came back in my life, he wouldn't explain why he was acting different. He just kind of acted mad at me, didn't know what I had done wrong. And when I brought up the dress and the event, because it was an event to support a charity I was really involved with at the time, and I said, you know, "Did you see that thing?" And he said, yeah, I think the whole world saw that, kid. That's how they'll remember you. That's how the world will remember you. And I was like, oh, come on. I mean, I felt good in it. I felt good. And he said, "Yeah, kid, that's what you're putting out there in the world. No one will ever forget that, and that's all they'll see you as. That's what you wanted. That's what you were going for, you know,
She talks about how Johnny was a very violent man and would tap into these monstrous moments.
Do you remember the first time that he physically hit you?
Yes.
Please tell the jury about it.
It's seemingly so stupid, so insignificant. I will never forget it. It changed my life. I asked him about the tattoo he has on his arm, and to me, it just looked like black marks. I didn't know what it said. It just looked like muddled, faded tattoo that was hard to read. And I said, "What does it say?" And he said, "It says wino." It says wino, and I didn't see that. I thought he was joking because it didn't look like it said that at all. And I laughed. It was that simple. I just laughed because I thought he was joking. And slapped me across the face. And I laughed. I laugh because I didn't know what else to do. I thought, this must be a joke. This must be a joke. Because I didn't know what was going on. I just stared at him, kind of laughing still, thinking that he was gonna start laughing too to tell me it was a joke. But second slap, I know he's not kidding, but I don't know what else to say or do, so I just stared at him. I didn't say anything, I didn't react. I didn't move or freak out or defend myself or say, what are you doing? You're crazy. I just stared at him because I didn't know what else to do. And he slaps me one more time. Hard. I lose my balance. At this point, we're sitting next to each other on the edge of the couch, or I was on the edge of the couch. And I'm all of a sudden realizing that the worst thing has just happened to me that could possibly happen to you. I realize that I wish so much he had said he was joking. Because it didn't hurt. It didn't physically hurt me. I was just sitting there on this carpet, looking at the dirty carpet, wondering how I wound up on this carpet and why I never noticed that the carpet was so filthy before, and I just didn't know what else to do. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know how to react. I just sat there thinking, how much time do I have till I figure out what I need to do? Because, God, did he just hit me?
But no matter what Johnny would do, because of Amber's background of growing up around and learning how to break horses, I'm not making this up, she would do whatever it took to try to change Johnny and his terrible ways. She thought she could save him by either staying quiet or making him face up to the reality of his actions. Here she is talking about her experience of breaking horses at the beginning of her testimony.
And what did your father do for a living?
My father broke horses and did construction, he painted houses.
Can you just tell the jury what your role is in assisting your dad on that and what is involved in breaking horses?
You just got to stay on, basically. I would help him. I was more of a crash test dummy. You know, when you train a horse, it's a wild animal. It doesn't necessarily like to be ridden. And there are people out there who are crazy enough, like my dad, to pick that as a profession, I guess. And he was really good with horses, and I was the son he never had. So it was my job to, you know, stay on.
And what, if anything, did you learn from your father about how to react to the horses?
Well, with training horses, I guess the key things are to not show fear, not get intimidated, not show fear, be tough and calm.
And here she is talking about her strategy of defending herself against Johnny.
It would escalate to the point where he would push me or shove me down, and then I'd get back up. And this happened several times. That's why it's not more specific, I suppose. When I'd get back up, I'd look him in the eye. I made a point of getting up and looking him in the eye. It's my way of defending myself at that time. And I'd look at him, and he'd ask me if I wanted to go again and shove me back down. Eventually, he just hit me. I remember he hit me in the face when I denied having an affair with my ex-wife, my ex-partner at the time. And he said he had proof. I denied it. And I was walking out of the bedroom, slapped me across the face. I turned to look at him. And I said, Johnny, you hit me. You just hit me.
Amber pulled out all the stops and went full theatrics to convince us that she was a scared, timid woman who felt trapped.
Why did you ask for a domestic violence temporary restraining order?
I wanted to change my locks.
But does this woman exist? Is she real? Even looking back on her own interviews, depositions, and recordings, this doesn't add up. Amber isn't timid. In fact, she's aggressive as hell. She fights, she throws things and insults in equal measure. This right here is fake. And let's talk about the PTSD, because that's a defense that she's been using in justifying her erratic behavior. Well, you know what? I'll let Dr. Curry explain Amber's supposed PTSD herself. For context, Dr. Curry is a psychologist who met with and performed an assessment on Amber by performing several interviews and tests, including one to gauge whether she was suffering from PTSD. The test itself has a control system to identify instances in which people are feigning symptoms instead of actually suffering from them.
Ms. Heard did not have PTSD, and there were also pretty significant indications that she was grossly exaggerating symptoms of PTSD when asked about them.
How did you make that latter conclusion?
So one of the strengths of this test, as I mentioned, the important thing about any test used when you're doing an evaluation in forensics is to make sure that the person is responding accurately. And this test does that by not just asking people whether they have a symptom, but asking follow-up questions that draw out very detailed accounts of every single symptom of PTSD. And when you're really familiar with this disorder, which you need to be to administer this test, there are nuances in the way a person will describe their symptoms that have been shown repeatedly to indicate exaggeration or faking. There are also indications when somebody is clearly giving you a genuine response.
So Amber is not suffering from PTSD and has not been able to sell us on her timid girl personality. Since, you know, we've seen all this.
Courtney, yeah. I can't do this if people are coming in and out of the door. It's really distracting. Okay. Extremely. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Wow. We met Jean-Claude Van Damme one time and we had to get a restraining order.
You know, they have had the Okay.
Let's talk about lie number two, that Amber Heard was being abused and struggled to leave her relationship with Depp. In her often very graphic descriptions of her abuse during her testimony, Amber was trying to get us all to accept that Johnny had her trapped in her relationship, often saying to her that this is, quote, till death. She explained that she often attempted to extricate herself from the situations of abuse, but that he wouldn't let her and would chase her down. But when listening to all the audio, it seems to be the opposite, that Amber is the one throwing things like bottles, pots, and pans, and Johnny is the one trying to get out of the situation, but she won't let him. Further testimony from Dr. Curry also sheds light that Amber is suffering from two personality disorders, histrionic and borderline personality disorders, meaning that she is prone to intense emotional volatility as well as a fear of abandonment. This, mixed with Johnny's self-defense system of leaving situations when they get too intense to handle, meant that while Johnny would try to leave, Amber would do whatever it took to keep him trapped and keep him there. During an incident in Australia, Amber Heard chased him out of 5 different rooms, including pushing a door into his head and punched him in the face just to prevent him from getting away from her. And then finally threw a bottle of liquor at his hand, which severed the tip of his finger. So turns out that instead of Amber being the one who was being controlled and abused, it was Johnny who was suffering physically, with plenty of evidence of his injuries over the many years of his relationship with Amber. This brings us to lie number three. Amber hid the signs of abuse from family, friends, and the public. Now, let me start off by saying that if you haven't watched Johnny Depp's lawyer, Camille Vasquez, cross-examine Amber, you should. Camille is intense and incredible. I will be using long clips in this video from those sections because she takes Amber to task on every one of her lies. The biggest one being that Amber was able to hide a broken nose, lots of bruising, basically the aftermath of all the egregious abuse she describes, using a bruise kit, that's what she calls it, and some ice. I'll let Camille talk you through this one.
This is a picture of you at the same event, the night after Mr. Depp allegedly whacked you in the face so hard you thought he broke your nose.
This is a picture of me after he did whack me in the face.
The night after, right?
Yes, it is. I believe it was the night after, yes.
Your nose doesn't appear to be injured in any of these pictures, does it, Ms. Heard?
I'm wearing makeup.
Your nose doesn't appear to be injured in any of these pictures, does it, Ms. Heard?
That's why I'm wearing makeup.
Right. And makeup covers up swelling, right?
Makeup will not cover up swelling. Ice will, though.
Ice will cover up swelling?
Ice reduces swelling. Normally, the swelling after that kind of injury is not as bad as you might imagine. And for me, it wasn't that bad. I have a picture of it underneath the makeup. That's how I know how to reference it.
A picture you haven't produced or shown to this jury, right, Ms. Hurd?
I've produced everything.
But you haven't shown it to this jury.
I would very much like to. It's not my job.
And that's not even to mention that Amber's description of how to cover up a bruise doesn't work in covering up bruises, but instead creates them.
And then if you want to cover up a bruise, you obviously put foundation first, concealer, and then on top of that, I used a bruise kit. Not a bruise kit, it's a theater makeup kit, a color correction kit, but I called it my bruise kit.
You can't make this stuff up. Well, Amber can. The proof of the abuse is just not there. It's not. Meanwhile, what do we see here, Elon? Maybe he caught some of Amber's love too. Let's talk about lie number 4. Amber cared about Johnny and wanted to protect his reputation. I mean, that's why she constantly covered up the injuries and hid the truth from his friends and the police, right? In May of 2016, Amber walked out of a courthouse with an apparent bruise on her face after filing for a restraining order against Johnny Depp at a time that he had already left for Europe. On the day that one of his movies was premiering, and on the day of his daughter's birthday. She also took a compromising video of him and released it to TMZ, having very carefully cut out any parts that made her look bad.
Ms. Hurd, you edited out the portions that made you look bad before sending it to TMZ.
You're very wrong about that.
Unfortunately for Amber, two things happened. One, a TMZ employee came to testify that he received a tip-off that Amber would be leaving the courthouse with a bruise on her face and that she would be stopping to show the cameras the bruise clearly.
You actually had alerted TMZ that you would be filing a TRO against Mr. Depp that very day, didn't you?
No, I did not.
The one day you didn't bother to wear makeup to cover up the mark on your face.
I did not call TMZ or any other news source or paparazzi source. No one.
I
never did that.
Testimony from former TMZ employee Morgan Tremaine yesterday, correct?
Did I hear his testimony?
Yes.
Yes, I was here.
Yes. And you heard Mr. Tremaine's testimony that he knew to dispatch the paparazzi to the courthouse on May 27th, right?
I heard him say that he knew that, yes.
Yeah, and that he dispatched paparazzi to the courthouse to capture a picture of an alleged bruise on the right side of your face. Do you remember him saying that?
I remember him saying that.
That information must have come from your team, right, Ms. Hurd?
Absolutely not.
By the way, here is a photo of Amber Hurd the day after she filed for the restraining order.
This is a picture of you on May 28th, 2016, right, Ms. Hurd?
I don't know when this was taken.
This is the day after you obtained the domestic violence restraining order against Mr. Depp, right?
I have no idea when this image was taken. I did not take it.
There's no bruise on your face in this picture, is there?
Again, I don't know when this was taken, and also I'm outside. I was obviously wearing makeup. I have no idea when this was taken, so I have no idea if I can speak to what bruise you can see or not.
Let's refresh your recollection about when this picture was taken.
Mr. Tremaine also testified that TMZ received the video of Johnny attacking the cabinets from the owner of the video.
Now, the video of Mr. Depp beating up some kitchen cabinets, you admit that you took that video, correct?
Yes, I did.
And you acknowledge that the video was released online the day before you were deposed in connection with your divorce from Mr. Depp in August of 2016, right?
I believe it was, yes.
But you testified that you had absolutely nothing to do with the video's release, right?
Absolutely not.
And you testified that you learned about it when you landed after flying into LA. Do you remember that testimony?
Upon touchdown is when I was alerted to the video's
existence
online. You
heard Mr. Tremaine testify about this video as well yesterday, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And you heard Mr. Tremaine testify that TMZ received the cabinet video the same day you landed at LAX, yes?
I don't know if that's what his testimony was, I'm sorry.
You heard Mr. Tremaine testify that the cabinet video was posted 15 minutes after TMZ received it, yes?
That's what I heard him say.
And that this could only have been possible if the video was received directly from the source, yes?
I heard him say that. I don't know if that's true or if that's possible. Because it didn't come from me. I was flying.
Tremaine.
So I know that's incorrect, is what I mean to say.
Another liar on the stand?
I just know that that's incorrect.
Right.
And number 2, there is a recording where she clearly explains to Johnny that she has years worth of texts and photos that she can use against him to convince the world that he has been abusing her.
Listen to me. defending yourself by throwing someone under the bus is not going to look good.
I'm not, it's not about that. It would not be about me throwing you under the bus. You know what it would be? It would be released through documented people coming on the record and having the protection to do so that haven't had yet. It would be eyewitness statements. It would be evidence, tons of it, and it would be through years.
And she pulled this threat out at a time where she could then extort him for money during their divorce. So this is a good time to talk about the final lie, lie number 5, that this was never about the money or fame, but rather justice.
I wanted nothing.
Edward White, Johnny's accountant and business manager, explained during his testimony how Amber's demands evolved during the negotiations of the couple's divorce settlement. Here he is during his testimony.
She initially was looking for a consideration of $4 million, but her demand continually increased. It went from $4 million to $5 million. Then it went from $5 million to $5.5 million. Then it went to $7 million. And then it was $7 million, and she demanded that Mr. Depp also pay $500,000 to her attorneys. So the next demand was that all of the community liabilities that were unresolved, approximately $13.5 million, that Mr. Depp had to pay those liabilities in its entirety. So at that point, she was demanding $14,250,000 of consideration, and then it got worse. The next demand was that all of this consideration be paid to her free of taxation.
Amber got what she wanted and walked away with her demands met. Here she is celebrating after her settlement. But faced with the increased criticism that Amber was doing this all for the money, she decided to donate all the money she received to charity. But hang on, how much money had they actually received from Amber? Here I'm going to play a long excerpt from Camille Vasquez's cross-examination of Amber Heard on the supposed donation, because it's unbelievable to watch.
So in this October 2018 interview, you said that you had, quote, donated, end quote, your entire divorce settlement to charity, right?
That's correct.
And in fact, your exact words were, quote, $7 million in total was donated to, I split it between the ACLU and the Children's Hospital of Los Angeles, end quote, right?
That's correct. I made that statement as soon as I got a divorce and we reached the settlement. That's when I pledged it, right then.
And you say this because you, quote, wanted nothing, end quote.
That is correct.
But you hadn't donated your entire $7 million settlement to charity at that point, had you?
That's incorrect.
Sitting here today, Ms. Heard, you still haven't donated the $7 million divorce settlement to charity. Isn't that right?
Incorrect. I pledged the entirety of
Ms.
the settlement, $7
million
to charity, and I intend to fulfill those obligations.
Ms. Heard, that's not my question. Please,
what was
try
your
to
question?
Answer my question. Sitting here today, you have not donated the $7 million, donated, not pledged, donated the $7 million divorce settlement to charity.
I use pledge and donation synonymous with one another.
But I don't. Ms. Heard, I don't use it synonymously.
That's how donations are paid.
Ms. Heard, respectfully, that's not my question. As of today, you have not paid $3.5 million of your own money to the ACLU. Yes or no?
I have not yet.
You had all of the $7 million for 13 months before Mr. Depp sued you, and you chose not to pay it to the charities you pledged it to. Is that correct, Ms. Heard?
I disagree with your characterization of that.
Another day, another lie. Because this was about the money, and this was about fame. Amber claimed that she, quote, spoke up against sexual violence and faced our culture's wrath. But that wasn't true. Despite not providing proof for a single one of her accusations, the Washington Post was willing to publish an op-ed that proved extremely detrimental to Johnny Depp's career and his life. She received plenty of praise for speaking up and was made an ACLU ambassador for gender justice. But the biggest prize was that the public was willing to believe her for one simple reason: justice. Right now, people can trade their victim status for clout simply because our society is eager to end injustice. Now, granted, we're going about it the wrong way, and this case is a great testament to how a manipulative, conniving woman who is hungry for money and fame can capitalize on her status of supposed victim to expand her influence and destroy a person's life. In her final cross-examination by Camille Vasquez, in the face of each lie being undone, Heard's main defense was that everyone was lying, including the bodyguards, Johnny's and Amber's friends, the TMZ employee, the photos, the recordings, the manager at Hicksville who witnessed her yelling at Johnny and Johnny literally cowering in front of her. That everyone, including Kate Moss, was here in defense of a man not because he is good and innocent, but because he is powerful and they all want to curry favor with him.
When you told this jury under oath that you punched Mr. Depp because you thought of Mr. Depp pushing Kate Moss down the stairs, you didn't expect Ms. Moss to agree to testify. That never happened, did you?
Incorrect. I know how many people will come out of the woodwork to be in support of Johnny.
So you think Ms. Moss needs to come out of the woodwork to testify for Mr. Depp?
Everybody who was around in the 90s and the early aughts knew that rumor. I had heard that rumor from multiple people. Of course, that's what flashed through my head when my violent husband not only swung for me, but all of a sudden swung for my sister. Of course I thought of that. I did not expect her to show up or not expect her to show up. It didn't matter. It doesn't change what I believed at the time when we were on the stairs and I thought he was going to kill my sister by pushing her down the stairs.
You told this jury under oath that Mr. Depp was aggressive and trashed a trailer in Hicksville. You didn't expect the manager of the Hicksville property, Morgan Knight, to come forward and testify that that was untrue, did you?
Incorrect. I've already been through trials with this man. I know how many people will come out in support of him.
When you told this jury under oath that you had no idea that the paparazzi would be at the courthouse on May 27th, 2016, you didn't expect a TMZ employee to show up to testify that TMZ had been alerted that you would be at the courthouse and knew exactly which side of your face to take a picture of, did you?
I know how many people will come out and say whatever for him. That's his power. That's why I wrote the op-ed. I was speaking to that phenomenon. How many people will come out in support of him and will fall to his power? He is a very powerful man, and people love currying favor with powerful men.
Currying favor know that firsthand. And risking jail time for committing perjury?
Excuse me? I didn't hear your question.
You didn't
Excuse
hear my
me?
Question?
Ms. Vasquez, if you do mind, please just repeat the question. I didn't hear you.
Curry favor and commit perjury in this courtroom?
I have seen
people do this. For a
powerful
man?
I have seen people do this time and time again.
And she's not entirely wrong. There are instances where a group of people will conspire to keep an enterprise going by hiding facts and paying people off, but the maxim stands that the truth will out. And once one brick falls from a pantheon, the rest follow pretty quickly, with all the little inconsistencies of a person's story becoming more and more obvious. But this time, it doesn't apply to Johnny. But to Amber herself. She's the woman that people kept quiet for. She's the one who was manipulating and lying to people because she was the protected party in this instance. Not because of her power as a rich white man, but because of her power as a supposed victimized woman. And our society's sensitivity to protecting women that have been wronged. She's the one who not only abused Johnny Depp, but also people's willingness to stand up for justice.
Ms. Heard, you just testified that this case has been very hard for you. So let's talk about that and why.
All right.
One of the repeated questions that Camille Vasquez had for Amber is that you didn't expect people to come to testify against all of your lies, did you?
You didn't expect Ben King, the house manager in Australia, to show up from England. He flew from England to testify that Mr. Depp's fingertip was found exactly where he said it would be, did you?
I have never heard Johnny testify to knowing where his finger was, or really, frankly, making a claim that he knew where it was when it was found. I've never heard Johnny claim that.
You didn't expect Keenan Wyatt.
Johnny has never said that.
Ms. Heard.
And
I think the jury can,
yes.
Ms. Heard, there's no question pending. You didn't expect Keenan Wyatt, Mr. Depp's longtime sound technician, to show up and testify that Mr. Depp is not being fed lines through his earpieces, but instead music, did you?
Not that it matters much, but of course I did. I know how his employees treat him.
So you probably,
I know how his team treats him. Of course I expected that.
Okay, so you probably expected Isaac Baruch to come and testify for Mr. Depp, right?
I'm not sure I thought about that.
Yeah, but you didn't expect Mr. Baruch to weep for Mr. Depp after what you've put him through and so many others with your lies.
I relate to Isaac because he and I are the only ones who have cried on this stand.
Nothing further.
All right.
The answer is no. She didn't expect all of her lies to be debunked. Amber Heard wasn't counting on any of this. She truly believed that we would all fall in line and just take her at her word under the banner of believe all women. And to that we all said, no. Thank you for watching, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this video. I have a few more videos in the pipeline about this case, so stay tuned. Please like, share, and subscribe. And please follow me on Twitter. It's a little harder now to track all the comments on YouTube, so if you ever want to interact with me, that's a great place to do it. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.